Hey YouTube, today we're going to be talking about two different applications that you can leverage to fine-tune your large language models using QLoRAs, the Alpaca-QLoRA and the official QLoRA. Now the Alpaca-QLoRA is significantly easier to install, but it doesn't have the power of the official QLoRA, specifically with being able to merge your LoRAs back into the model itself, significantly increasing inferencing speed. But it took several hours to be able to get the official QLoRA stood up versus 5 minutes for the Alpaca-QLoRA. I have created some custom repos to hopefully make this easier for people using WSL and Windows, but if you'd like to skip to either, feel free to jump to the chapters below, but otherwise, let's get started. Before we actually get into fine-tuning, let's do a quick walkthrough on how to actually get this set up correctly, because I had a lot of trouble, so I'd like to help anybody else who has the same troubles that I did. Now, I was not able to get it to run on Windows. I had to pivot to WSL, where I was able to get things to run, except for BitsAndBytes. There was a problem with CUDA hardware compatibility, specifically with the BitsAndBytes library throwing an error of unexpected ordinal. So if you run into this issue, I do have my own custom fork of the repo, which you can clone with the command below in the description. And once you have cloned that, all we have to do is cd into the BitsAndBytes directory, and we're going to run a couple of commands. So first, we're going to run export CUDA version equals, and you're going to set this to your CUDA version. So in my case, it's 11.7, so I'm going to set it to 11.7. And then, oh, and also all of these commands will be in the description below. And then we're going to run make CUDA 11x. We're going to hit enter. It takes about a minute for this to run, so we'll be right back. So once that's done running, we're now just going to actually set up our custom installation of BitsAndBytes. So how we can do that is we're going to first make sure that the other installation of BitsAndBytes is gone, and we'll do that by running pip uninstall BitsAndBytes. So if that is still installed, you can run, you know, hit yes, go ahead and let it get deleted. And then we're just going to run the following command, python setup.py. And this is all in the BitsAndBytes top directory from the one that we checked out. And then we're going to run python setup.py install. And that's it, it's installed. So now let's move on to actually running the application itself. If you feel comfortable making modifications to the code, we do need to make a couple of changes in QLoRA.py, specifically for us to be able to leverage custom datasets. But if you don't feel comfortable making the changes, there will be a repo in the description below that you can check out and use in your environment, and it will already have the changes made for you. But if you do feel comfortable making the changes, we just need to append the following lines after 522, and these will be in the repo as well. And we need to make a change to the prompt dict class to include the output for the response. Otherwise, the loss function doesn't have anything to update against. So once we've made these changes, now we need to prepare ourselves for what we need to consider for using QLoRA right now. Unfortunately, for the moment, it appears that QLoRA only supports structured text, so it doesn't support unstructured or raw. So this means that we do need to be aware of what our foundational model expects for a structured fine tune. Like in the example of Alpaca, it expects an instruction input output, and we need to have our data in that format. Though I expect that raw and unstructured will be supported soon enough. But for the moment, we want to consider why is QLoRA so incredibly important here, and it's about the quality and the size of the data set required to achieve the same thing that we were achieving in LoRA. So with QLoRA, we're attaching these LoRAs to every single layer that we can, whereas in LoRA or standard LoRA, we were only attaching it to a single layer. So this results in a much higher quality fine tune, and we can make a much larger influence on the network with our fewer samples. So if we look at this data set, it is a fairly small data set, but we should be able to have the same impact as a larger version of this. And this is just the same one I was using before with MedQuad QA. But now that we have an idea of what we're going to be training, let's go ahead and move on to getting ourselves set up to actually do it. Now let's go over what these hyperparameters do for us. The model name or path is the model that you plan to train. This can be given as an absolute or relative path. And if you give it as a relative path, just make sure it's in the same place as where your script is. The output directory is where all of your training metadata will be saved to. This includes checkpoints and other statistics. The dataset is the dataset that you plan to train with. Do train is probably not going to change. We want this to be true, but you could change the defaults if you don't want to change train and you just want to run an evaluation. Do eval tells us whether we want to do an evaluation this run as well. Do MMLU. MMLU is a particular benchmark for large language models, and we can set this to true if we want that to run at the end of this as well. Source max length is the maximum input length for our prompts, and target max length is the maximum generation that we should be expecting. The batch sizes, I don't recommend that we change those. These four seems to be a pretty decent value for this. Gradient accumulation steps, though, this could be something worth changing. This says how many steps do we want to take before we start propagating our gradients back into our LoRAs. Logging steps, how many steps do we want to take before we create logs for our training run. Our maximum steps is how many steps do we want to take in this particular run. Our save strategy is based on steps. Probably not a lot of reason to change this. Our data seed is the value that will be used for seeding the LoRAs initially. Our save steps are how often do we want to create checkpoints. Our save total limit is how many checkpoints do we want to create in total. Our evaluation strategy is also based in steps and probably does not need to change. And our evaluation dataset size tells us how large is our evaluation dataset from our source dataset. And then evaluation steps is how often do we want to actually run an evaluation. But now our optimizer. The optimizer is where we have the largest range of choices with well over a dozen. And all of them will be in the description below, though Atom W32-bit is pretty performant, so there's probably not a lot of reason to switch from that one. But the 8-bit version does have a bug right now where loss goes out of control. I've seen that reported a couple of times, those issues on their GitHub. So just be wary of that if you see any issues with that. But we also want to talk about what we can change in our LoRAs. And we can do that through parameters or inside the code here. So for example, we can tweak our LoRa rank, which by default is 64. And if you remember, that is the size of the LoRa. And the larger the LoRa, the more weights that you have to tweak, so you can get a more fine tune. But the LoRa alpha is how much of an impact does that LoRa have when we start adding their values together. So the higher the alpha, the higher that addition, the lower the value, the lower that addition. The dropout controls how well do we prevent overfitting and other issues from these LoRAs. That's probably not worth touching this value unless you really feel like you need to. But the other values, the most important one is going to be the learning rate. If you have a model larger than 13 billion, it is worth probably increasing the learning rate just to get better gradients. But now let's move on to actually starting our fine tune. So once we have our data set and the large language model that we want to fine tune, and we set the hyperparameters the way we want them to be, after we execute the fine tuning procedure, three things are going to happen. The fine tune itself, creation of checkpoints, and finally, we're going to create a merge. And that merge is where things are very different than they have been with other LoRAs. So LoRAs up until now have been attached to a single layer, and they can be attached and detached, but in QLoRA, they are attached to every layer that they can be. And when the model is being saved, we want to create a merge. So we merge the weights from the LoRAs back into the layers, kind of like what they were doing in Stable Diffusion for quite a long time now, but are now present in LLMs. And then we'll be able to launch it like we normally would inside of a UI. So to start our training process, we're going to call the script that we modified. And I'm in the top level directory in QLoRA, so I'm going to run sh, and I'm going to call scripts, and we're going to call finetune.sh. So now once we run this, it will take a significant amount of time to run. In my case, it's going to take several hours. So once it's done, we'll come back. Now, once your model is done training, we're going to go into wherever you ask the output to be, which in my case was just output, and we should see a checkpoint that's been generated. So if we go into this checkpoint, we see that there are There is an adapter model and some other stuff that now exists. What we care about is the adapter model. And as long as that is now there and it's a bin file, we can now start the process of merging our LoRA or new QLoRA into our old model so we can load it into other UIs. And that is just done with a script that I've created called merge.py, and this is in my repo for this. So if you want to copy the code, feel free. But all you should have to model or modify is where your model path is and the adapter path. So after you've modified those, all you have to do is simply run the script and it should handle the rest of it for you. And let me show you how that's done really quickly. And all we should have to do is cd back into my output folder here. And we should just have to run Python merge.py, let this run, and it'll handle the merge for you, and we'll show you what you get after it's done running. After you're done saving, you should now have a saveme.bin or whatever you've chosen to name the file. And now you can just move this into your models in Ubabuga or whichever preferred chat UI you like. And you should just be able to start the model up. You'll need to bring along any of the additional metadata from the model though. So your tokenizer, your config.json and so forth. But then it should just boot. And but now I would like to show y'all a tool that was significantly easier to work with and only took about 10 minutes to get stood up instead of 8 hours. After struggling with the official QLoRA, I was able to find this repository, which was significantly easier to work with. And I'll be linking that in the description below, but let me show you how to work with it really quickly because it's considerably easier. So all we have to do is clone it just like we have the other repositories. We cd in, and all we have to do to fine tune is run this command line, at least on Llama models. They do have extensive examples for other models that they support, including Pythia and StableLM. But it is a much easier model to work with. You just run this and it handles the rest of it. It doesn't have the instabilities that the official QLoRA appears to have right now. And you just have to hit enter, let it run, and we'll come back once it's finished running. After the fine tuning is completed, all we have to do now is simply start the web application with a single command line. And we just have to pass it the base model that we trained it with and where the LoRA weights were stored. And we just hit enter and it will run the rest for us. And it will take a while for it to load, especially on a local machine. It's just, there's a lot of complexity happening, attaching the various LoRA matrices to the attention layers. And unlike the official QLoRA, they don't support merging that I saw yet. I believe they plan to support it, but it does not look like it's supported yet. So without the ability to merge, the inferencing will be slower, but it's just so much easier to at least test your QLoRAs on this than it was on the previous application. And we still have the ability to tweak a lot of the hyperparameters that we had on the other application, but it's just so much more straightforward on this. There was so fewer issues than there were on the other. So now we will wait for it to boot, and when it comes back, we'll see how well it performs. Once the app is running, it's just like any of the chat apps that we're used to. And in this case, we can just test out our fine tune. So the instruction in this case is you are a medical expert and you will answer questions related to medical inquiries. And the input will be how to diagnose myositis, fungioids, and Sarzi syndrome. And let's see how well it performs. And, oh, whoops, I forgot to stream the output. That typically helps. Now, the LoRAs do have an impact on the overall inferencing speed for these models. So unfortunately, it does make them a little slower, and that is an advantage of the primary QLoRA package. If you can use it to do the merge, you don't have such a massive impact on your network. So, but that's really it. These are the two main approaches right now to performing QLoRAs, and they're very similar, but one is certainly much easier than the other. If this was helpful, please like and subscribe, and let us know in the comments below what you'd like to hear about next. And please tune in tomorrow at 6 p.m. Mountain Standard Time for when we're going to be having our next Q&A session. And tune in next time when we'll be discussing the power behind Iker tokens and much wider context in open source models. See y'all next time.